It's been such an honor to work on this program alongside my colleagues in the Adult Programs Department, our curators Terry Carbone and Kelly Jones, and all the artists that are here today. We'd also like to thank the Ford Foundation for their support of this program. There are some exhibitions that profoundly impact the way we see the world around us, and Witness does just that. That art has the power to spark conversation, to shape debate, and to push us forward is evident from the work in the exhibition and by the artists we'll hear from today. Our schedule for the day is listed on your programs. We encourage you to stay all afternoon and join us for the reception afterwards. Also, if you have not had a chance to see the Witness exhibition on the first floor, we encourage you to take some time to do so. Now, without further ado, please help me in welcoming to the stage curator Terry Carbone, artists Jack Witten, Bruce Davidson, Mark DeSubaru, Latoya Ruby Frazier, and Abigail DeVille. Thank you.
Idea and practice of art that is activist. Although you may already know who's who, I'm just going to run down the line here. We have Jack Witten, Abigail DeVille, Latoya Ruby Frazier, Bruce Davidson, and Mark DeSubaru. We're going to begin by having each of our panelists speak for about 5 minutes individually about their activism and art. In doing so, I've asked them to think about two things. First, the personal experience or particular place that generated their activism. And second, the community of colleagues or mentors, if there was such a community, within which they created this work. So I'd like to begin with Jack.
Okay. First, I would like to say I'm from Bessemer, Alabama. I'm born in 1939. That means that I grew up in the height of the civil rights movement. My mom used to hold meetings at home to teach people how to pass the test for voting. You couldn't just go vote. You had to pass a test to vote. And on top of that, you had to pay poll tax. It was a big thing. I grew up with memory of Ku Klux Klan actually parading down our street more than once. I grew up with horrific things, a lot of stuff that I don't even talk about anymore. My first encounter with activism was in Baton Rouge, Louisiana in 1959. That was what drove me from the South. I was a student at Southern University and took part in one of the first demonstrations in Baton Rouge. At that time, Baton Rouge, that was one of the worst spots in the South that one could be. What started as a very peaceful demonstration ended up being something extremely violent, extremely nasty. That's what changed my mind. That's why I left the South. I had met Martin Luther King when I was a freshman at Tuskegee Institute in 1957, and I believed in what he was saying. But I warn all of you, it's one thing to believe in the theory of something, but when it switches over to actual realism, it will change you. I agreed to this march, I did it, but I vowed that I would never do it again.
Jack, do you want to just say a bit about your transition to New York and who you started to work around when you arrived?
When I first came to New York, a lot of part of 59, I fell into the Cedar Bar crowd. I was a student. I came to New York to stay. I took a Greyhound bus from New Orleans to New York. I ended up on the Lower East Side of Manhattan. Some of the first people I met, just through circumstance, was Bill LeCun and Franz Klein. Later, Robert Blackburn, who was a instructor at the Cooper Union. He worked in the printmaking workshop. And Robert Blackburn took me to see Romare Bearden. And Romare Bearden was the main introduction in the black arts community. Romare Bearden took me to see Norman Lewis. It was Romare Bearden who took me to see Jacob Lawrence. I was fortunate in coming to New York. I had the opportunity to meet both sides of the divide. And that was very fortunate for me to be able to do that. It shaped a lot of my ideas, being able to go and speak with Bearden, to speak with Lawrence, to go uptown, to speak with Lewis, and at the same time being able to speak with Bill LeCun, it meant a lot for me. So it helped, I must say that helped to shape who I am today.
Great. I should mention that while each of our panelists is introducing their discussion, there will be slides behind us. Here are two works by Jack, both from 1964. On your left, Birmingham 1964, which is in the witness show downstairs, and on the right, Head Number 7. So Bruce, I'm going to ask you to speak next.
Well, I'm just amazed at this gentleman's life. My life was quite different. I grew up in the Midwest. My mother was a single parent. She worked in a torpedo factory during the Second World War. And my brother and I were taught to be self-sufficient. We could cook, we could clean. We could meet our mother at the corner store to help her with groceries and that kind of thing. But the decisive moment in my life was I had spent 1959, a year with the Brooklyn teenagers, a gang called the Jokers. And at the end of the year, the mafia got a hold of the fact that I was photographing and there might be money in it. And so I had to leave New York. I went to England. And then I came back and I started to photograph a project I called Youth in America, based on my Brooklyn gang experience. Someone said, well, you ought to go down to Jackson, Mississippi, and be with the young people who are on a bus. I didn't know, I had no idea what that was. But it sort of intrigued me. Youth, bus, a project I received a Guggenheim Fellowship to follow through on. And so I started, and it just changed me completely because I rode on the bus. I was with them. And so for the next 4 or 5 years, I photographed in most of the demonstrations throughout the North and South. And that's all I have to say. Except the photograph of Viola La Russa was important to me. I heard that she had been shot, and I knew approximately where the car was, and I got up at 4:30 and before the police get there, and I was able to take one or two frames before the police started chasing me. They more than chased me, they took their weapons out of their holsters. And but you can see in the black and white photograph the blood stains on the seat, and the fact that there was a woman there who was shot by the Ku Klux Klan. Anyway, there it is. So 4 years of intensive work, and that's the way it worked. Now, the important thing about my experience in 4 years on the civil rights movement, I suddenly felt the need to photograph one block in New York, and I did. I photographed East 100th Street for 4 years, making 4,000 individual images. I gave prints to people, and I still go back. There's a funeral or a party, a block party, people are still inviting me back to East 100th Street. And then the rest of my life is keep going. It's just about keep going.
Thanks, Bruce. We have Mark next.
I was there when Martin Luther King spoke. We went down carrying a sign against police brutality. My brother worked very hard in Newark, Emergency Civil Liberties Union, and he put the Newark Police Department into receivership when they were shooting blacks in the street. I was born in China, but the whole thing is that the moment that we have changed, we who have worked for, you know, the marches, the whatever we could do, we have changed the world. You can change the world if you act united, if everybody is willing to do it and understands that the cause is just, you can organize and do it. I've been arrested in Chicago and Washington, D.C. Most recently, I've never been arrested in this town before, but most recently arrested against the re-election of George Bush. But the real thing to know is that it can be done. We stopped the war in Vietnam. And, you know, we're all related. We're one family. And the blood is always red. There are violent people out there. But if you have that idea that Gandhi had, you know, of nonviolence, the cops, when they saw me in a nonviolent position in Chicago, had nothing to, they didn't know how to react, so they grabbed me, threw me into the pool, where it was very cold that day. They didn't want to go in the pool after me, or they picked me up afterwards, you know, the usual thing. But if you have this kind of ideal, and you work with people, and they have it too, well, you can change the world.
Do you want to say a word about the Artist Tower piece from a protest from 1966?
In Chicago, that was in L.A.?
In L.A., which is on the left side of the screen here.
Yeah, right. We built that all together, and artists from all over gave their works, their paintings. Everybody did their paintings, and then they wouldn't allow us to put it onto the tower. You're going to run up against constantly, you know, like they say, no, it can't change, it can't happen, you know, like we have these laws, but you can do it anyway. And that's the real secret. The other one is a piece that I made in a parking lot. I worked alone building it, took a couple of months. I like working with steel because it has just enough flexibility. And we all live on iron. Our blood, which is all related, our blood needs hemoglobin, which is iron. That's what carries the oxygen around. And I've always liked steel because David Smith and Milton Resnick and other people were great friends of mine.
Great, thanks. And we'll hear from LaToya next. Two images by LaToya are on the screen now.
So, good afternoon. And it's really an honor to be up here. I mean, I'm very young. I was born in 1982. I'm not part of the exhibition. And And I was really touched going through the show because, you know, thinking about contemporary art and where work like mine can exist, this type of social documentary work that's concerned about human rights issues and equality and race and class issues, we don't really see that reflected currently. There's really no place for it in contemporary art, and seeing an exhibition like this here at the Brooklyn Museum gives me that inspiration and hope that what I'm doing actually is valid and important. So for 12 years, I've been making work on my family and community. I'm from Braddock, Pennsylvania. It's 9 miles outside of Pittsburgh. It's Andrew Carnegie's hometown. It's where he came from Scotland, and he started the Edgar Thomson plant, which was established in 1872, and also the first Carnegie Library, which is in Braddock, established in 1889. So my work really grapples with the invisibility of men and women from my community that for decades have been omitted and overlooked in the history, the grand American narrative history, as well as the media representation of what's currently happening in Braddock. And so, in the same vein as someone like Gordon Parks or even someone like Bruce Davidson, I began picking up my camera and using it as a tool and a weapon to speak back towards things I don't like about America, which is discrimination, inequality, and racism. And the way that my work has expanded over the years is going from the personal autobiographical narrative work of my grandmother, my mother, and me. My grandmother grew up in the 1930s when Braddock was very prosperous and a melting pot and had a lot of power. My mother grew up in the 60s during segregation and after the GI Bill started to influence our white counterparts to move away and disinvest in Braddock. And then I grew up in the 1980s, which was followed by the war on drugs, where I witnessed my whole family and community be decimated. And so I felt that it was very necessary to make a human document that spoke honestly and earnestly to the real situation at hand and the severity of what happened after the steel mill industry collapsed in the 70s and the subsequent abuse by our government, local and state level, against African-American communities. And so the image that you see of Mr. Jim Kidd in front of the hospital was actually, you know, these images are now. The one of my grandmother, she passed away in 2009, and the one of Mr. Jim Kidd in front of the Braddock UPMC hospital was taken in 2011. So imagine a community of mostly elderly people that are disenfranchised, underemployed people that no longer are employed by the factory, even though it's still there. So the United States Steel Corporation has abused us and discarded our bodies, and now the healthcare system has also decided to abandon us. So not only do we not have jobs, we don't have healthcare. And so it became very necessary for me to start to show up at a site like Braddock Hospital with Mr. Jim Kidd holding a sign that says race-based, class-based healthcare and really grappling with the reality. Currently, you would hear more narratives about Braddock being a new place for urban pioneers, but the reality is actually what's here in this photograph with Mr. Jim Kidd. There's no media discussion that is dealing with the fact that Braddock is one of the most polluted towns and cities in the United States. And so, you know, through me seeking a correction of American history and art and social justice, I've taken it upon myself to produce a counter narrative and to build my own archive to preserve our history.
Thanks, Latoya. Abigail?
So I'm Bronx, born and raised. I think the formative moment for me was the end of Giuliani's reign of whatever. I was a high school senior and Amadou Diallo got shot, you know, 41 times and the cops were acquitted. And it was in that moment, like being 17 and thinking about being a self-possessed person and actually trying to navigate, you know, spaces in this world, but actually that your body doesn't really belong to you, that there's already an inscribed history that people are projecting onto it. And So I think that definitely planted a seed for me to start thinking about ideas of invisibility, or thinking about the visible representation of the invisible. And these two works right here, one, the first one being at the New Museum in 2012, and the second at the Studio Museum in 2012. The first one is called Dark Days, but it was based on this documentary of quote-unquote mole people that were living underground and had built homes for themselves that had running water, electricity, and they were a community of people that took care of each other, and they documented their story. But they were being moved, they were being forced to move and relocate. And thinking about the placement or the history of the Bowery, the placement of the new museum, and this driving force of redevelopment and to move sort of the invisibles or the undesirables or poor people that are constantly being shifted and tossed around this city since the very inception of it. But think about that also in relation to, at the same time I was thinking about this space at the new museum, I saw a show of Jacob Riis's photos, and I saw how those spaces that people had created for themselves at the turn of the 19th into 20th century mirrored the exact spaces that these people had created for themselves in the late 90s, early 2000s underground. But then the other day I saw an article online of people living underneath the Manhattan Bridge. And so the things, it's a continual kind of way of people having to be forced to navigate certain kinds of claustrophobic spaces. And then in the second piece, Harlem Tower of Babel, was me thinking about the oppression of very specific New Yorkers over the 20th century. But all the materials on the outside of the sculpture were rusted, and they came from a beach in South Brooklyn called Dead Horse Bay that was a little town that Robert Moses bulldozed down to the ground. And the debris from some of those homes is still on the beach. So there's like Depression era Clorox bottles and things like that. So I was able to get those things and put it on the outside of the piece. And in the interior, there's domestic objects that belong to my grandmother, who was a part of what I consider this invisible class of New Yorkers, and things that came from her Bronx apartment that she lived in for 50 years.
Thank you. I'm going to ask a few questions of Jack, Bruce, and Mark, whose works are included in the Witness exhibition. And then I'm going to turn the floor over to Latoya and Abigail, who will continue the conversation. So I'm going to back up to Jack's work. It seems like invisibility is something that is really at play here, and the effort to overcome it. And I want to ask Jack if he could speak a little. When we first were talking about Birmingham, 1964, almost a year ago, Jack, you were talking about the materials you used here, including the veil of stocking mesh in the middle of this work, which sort of presents almost like a battle between the devices of abstraction and a realistic documentary image. Could you talk a little bit about the notion of the veil at the center of this work?
Well, first of all, that photo is the famous photograph that a bunch of different artists used. It was well known, it was distributed throughout the world, that photo. For me personally, when I saw that, when it came across the newsstand, my reaction was, this is my hometown that this took place in. So for me, it was extremely personal. The veil was used, of course, metaphorically, and not so metaphorically, really. It came right out of Du Bois' Soul of Black Folks. It's everything that he spoke about was a notion of this veil that we were forced to live under, that we really couldn't see the outside because of this. I use that to peer into. That's a wound. That thing is really torn open, to pull open, to peel apart. It's a wound. Something pierced that. Those hosts, a host is a weapon when it's used at that high pressure. It knocked the hell out of you. It's a weapon. That's what was used on those kids that day, and of course the dogs. But that thing was built as a wound that was actually cut to open and to reveal something that happened deep down. It was a personal reference for me. The piece on the right is hard to see. It came from a group of things that I did, a series in the early 1960s. I had just came out of art school, and I was looking for a way to penetrate something, and I had no way of doing it. I turned to process. I grew up with the story of a picture that occurred in a courthouse window. My father was born in Mississippi. We would go to Mississippi to visit my granddaddy and the distant family. We passed through this small town on the border of Mississippi and Alabama. There was a window there in the courthouse with an image. The story is that even when the glass was removed and restored with new glass, that this image would appear. I remember this. We would be in a car going to Mississippi, and we would pass through this town. It's the story of a man that was lynched. They claim that he was on the second floor of the courthouse, staring out at the mob that was gathering in the courtyard. A very strong thunderstorm happened, which is frequent in Alabama. And there was a flash, a big bolt of lightning. And they claimed that the lightning etched this man's image into the window. I grew up with that story. It was pointed out to me. I couldn't have been more than 3 years old, 4 years old, but I remember this. All of those paintings that I did from this period are ghost images. This one is called Lynching. That image was seared into my brain. It was something, though, that I couldn't paint. I couldn't take up a brush and paint it. Later, through reading, especially the German philosophy herself, the word is eidetic. It's an image. It's an old ancient word, really. In truth, some people think it's the beginning of the icon. It is something that one cannot paint. It is something that your hands cannot do. It is something that exists as imagery through the notion of process. You find this kind of imagery. It's something that has always intrigued me. All of those paintings were done with that thought in mind. That's lynching. Again, it's very hard to see. Some of them will be shown, though. The curator who was curating my first retrospective at the San Diego Museum of Contemporary Art, opening in September, we're going to show those paintings. First time they've ever been shown. I never had the opportunity to show them. My first art dealers here in New York, Alan Stone, who was very helpful in giving me my first show, told me point blank, those are not paintings. So I put them on the back burner.
What did he want instead?
Them up and put them away.
What did he want that you were doing? What did he want to show that you
well,
were?
This is 1964. The abstract expressionists are still running full realm in New York City. Just real abstraction. Building Cooling and Klein and the whole bit. Alan was a promoter of the abstract expressionists. And I being a follower at that time of Building Cooling, doing gestural abstract works. Alan loved them, so he gave me my first show built on those paintings. But those things, those are process paintings. They were built by taking a piece of mesh, again, nylon, very thin mesh, stretching it over cotton duck, trapping the acrylic in between a layer of mesh and cotton duck, and literally removing the excess paint. They are, all of you, upon seeing those paintings, would swear that you're looking at fuzzy photographs. That's what they look like. It led me to go to my studio wall, and I wrote on my studio wall in bold letters, the image is photographic, therefore I must photograph my thoughts. That caused a lot of problems in my young mind, because for a number of years there, I walked around thinking that I was a camera. It's a funny thought. But by 1968, 69, walking around thinking that you were a camera caused some serious psychological problems. So I put those further photographic paintings fast on the back burner. Only recently, though, now I've had a discovered a way to penetrate that kind of imagery, again through process. I'm now dealing with paint, where I take the paint through three different processes: construction, deconstruction, and reconstruction. The paint now has become what I call a fragment, a tessera. The acrylic is broken into fragmented pieces, and the image is built from those fragments. It gives me the opportunity to penetrate that kind of stuff. The veil, coming out of DuBois. This young lady, Latoya, see the photograph there of DuBois. Abigail, I'm sorry. Excuse me. The last painting out of my studio is entitled DuBois' Legacy. If DuBois had not written that book, The Soul of Black Folks, and if he had not stood up for the principle of aesthetics, I wouldn't be here today. It wouldn't be possible for me to be here today. It wouldn't be possible for me to do what I'm doing. I went to Tuskegee. Tuskegee was Booker T. Washington. That was his baby. It was Du Bois, though, who led the path that black folks deserve the right to make the inquiry into aesthetics, not just the vocational, not just the sweat of one's brows, but the sweat of one's brain. It's the mind. With that, we were able to penetrate the veil.
Thanks, Jeff.
It's an amazing thing.
Bruce, I wanted to address the next question to you. You mentioned your work on the Brooklyn Gangs project in 1959, and then you head to the South. And I'm wondering what was the difference in the way you worked. You similarly immersed yourself in your subject, but as you've mentioned, you didn't use a telephoto lens. You were using a Leica, right? How did you immerse yourself in this new setting and your new subject?
Well, there's some. After the Brooklyn Gang was published, Alex Lieberman at Vogue magazine called me into his office, and he said, I had lunch with Cartier-Bresson, and I asked Cartier-Bresson if the young Davidson could do fashion. He said, well, look, if he can do gangs, he certainly can do fashion. So Vogue gave me a big, fat contact. I photographed all the top models, never took any of them out for coffee or anything. They were all much too tall for me, and I was too naive. Then I went down to Montgomery, Alabama, to ride on the Freedom Rides. And then, after that experience, I called Lieberman up, and I said, I'm not doing any more fashion. It's gone. I'll go to countries for you. I'll do portraits for you, but I no longer will do fashion for you. And that sustained me over all the years that I photographed on my own. I wasn't assigned. I liked it better that way. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, absolutely. And how did you sort of choose your subjects after the bus trip that you made? You know, other works in the show, like the car, Viola Liuzzo, and the Klan shot, which is an amazing photograph done at night. How did you find yourself at these places?
In terms of the Klan cross-burning that I witnessed, I was in Atlanta and they were handing out leaflets. The leaflet said, there's a cross burning and it will be on such and such farm. And I took it down and I went there just after dark. At that time I had a little Volkswagen and I got too close to the fire and they made an announcement, New York plates, such and such, you're too close to the fire. And I knew I had to get out of there. I'm still running. one of the most moving things that happened on the Selma March was I met Mrs. Anna Mae Blackman, who had 7 or 8 children, a sharecropper, and she allowed me to photograph her holding her youngest child. Years later, after the march was over, I went back and I found the whole family. And the younger children had gone to school. The older children, couldn't have gone. The old adult, they didn't. They still were illiterate. But the children all had really wonderful lives. One was the attorney reading specialist at she had a master's degree. I mean, I'm photographing her at a potbelly stove, you know, in a cabin. And then years later, she becomes the senior legal librarian, the state capitol in Montgomery. And John Blackman has his own energy truck. He buys and sells air conditioning equipment. He's an engineer. So each child I re-photographed, and we had a wonderful time just being together. The baby that I in the window, she's a insurance agent for farmers in that area. All but one still live in that area of Alabama. So that was what my photographs are really for, to bring a new awareness and larger awareness.
Thanks, Bruce. And getting back to Mark, when the whole idea of the tower protest came about, you were in LA for a show, I believe. How did your involvement in that begin?
I think that when people are working for peace, that they gravitate towards each other. They help each other. What we can do together is what is important. Right now, a group of artists and myself have changed a plot of land that was considered garbage, and it's called Socrates Sculpture Park. But it is this idea of working together. There was a book, Bruce, by a friend of mine, most of the photographs in it, called The Movement. And I think that photography has changed that this whole world that we live in. You look at these, I'm sorry, I'm a sculptor. You look at these two-dimensional things, you can turn them over, and you know the backside is always blank. But sometimes you can see the image of injustice, you can see the image of something that needs to be changed. And, you know, you guys are young. You can change the world.
Thanks. I'm going to turn the floor over now to Latoya and Abigail and ask them to ask whatever they would like of our fellow panelists here. Anyone prefer to begin, or Latoya?
I would ask one of them a question.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Yeah, I think this question would be for Mr. Davidson. In terms of looking at documentary and the position that it's in, where it's at today, versus when you made East 100th Street, you know, I'm a young practitioner that, you know, really believes in social documentary and the fact that it can counter social representations that promote racism, class issues, gender issues, issues of citizenship. And there's not really much support necessarily that's out there currently. It operates in its own realm. Like, for example, in this exhibition, there are approximately 30 images. And I can see, you know, how photography was so important in terms of changing our minds and preserving our history and making us remember the legacy of America, but there's such a gap today. We don't have that opportunity to have these conversations in our classrooms. We don't have that support necessarily currently at these institutions that are determining what is valid or what's in the market. I've been told myself that my work's not fashionable, it's not important. Why are you making this work? But it's this conviction and hope that, you know, this is the thing that I need to do and why I'm here. And I wonder if you could speak to that and, you know, what your understanding and point of view is of this gap that's happening generationally, and also how you were able to continue to just work, you know, personally, because I just, you know, work quietly with myself knowing that I need to make this work.
I'm not an activist. Most of my work is about my own personal growth as a human being. The photographs must be human. They cite some humanity. But I'm not an activist per se. East 100th Street was important to me. I was single. I lived in a one-room apartment with a sliding door for a darkroom kitchen combination with a red light and a ruby light in the refrigerator. I lived pretty much like a monk, and I would just every day go to East 100th Street and hang out. I had no agenda, and I didn't want to meet any organizations, although the organization called Metro North gave me permission to photograph in their neighborhood. The first day on 100th Street was very important to me. I was standing there with my large format camera, tripod, and a strobe. And a woman came up to me and she said, "What are you doing, young lad? What are you doing?" And I said, "Oh, I'm photographing the ghetto." And she said, "What you call a ghetto, I call my home." And that gave me the feeling, the necessary feeling to be in the homes and photograph people in their homes. And then the photographs were always donated to the community. They had photographs. And sometimes I saw my photograph in their apartment. And sometimes they cut out somebody. So it became dynamic. Those photographs ended up, are now, have a home. They were first shown at the Museum of Modern Art, and then the Boston Museum of Fine Arts acquired it. So that old East 100th Street body of work is in a safe place, that someone can use that as research. If that answers your question.
Yeah, well, now I'm starting to think about very particular images in this body of work, and I don't know if you've been challenged or criticized, you know, critically by people about some of the nude images versus some of the other ones where they're, you know, clothed and they're standing in their apartments. But I wonder, your decision in terms of editing that work, What was the difference for you, or the strategy, or the reason that, you know, there were these really elegant, beautiful images of like a mother and a child nude on their bed versus the ones where they're actually standing there? Like, is there a difference there, or politically, or why was that necessary to show those images together, and why you kept some of those in the book?
There's always a story behind the story. I had an assistant from the block, Jose Rosa, who said that he had his cousin wants to be a model. And I said, well, would she agree to photograph in a nude with her child, but covered up? I mean, it's not an explicit image. And so we photographed her, and then I sent the photographs to Vogue, and they ran them. And so she became a top model, just by virtue of being published. There are only two or three nudes in that. I'm very shy. They had to come out of somebody. One woman was pregnant and she wanted to be seen. There might have been others. You know, I think if I had the opportunity, I'd photograph everybody nude. But I don't have the opportunity.
Thank you.
Well, I guess this question is for Mr. Quinton. Thinking about what you said about double consciousness and thinking about self-possession and the skins and the processes of paint and the layers of paint that you use, and then almost the way that they're cut in a grid formation, or like when you used the Afro pics and the raping. Are all of these things, is this in reference to specifically the violent, just the violent history of that has like genetically altered the African Americans, their experience, the way that they function within different social spaces, legacies that are projected onto them, whether they're aware of them or not, is all of these things. Thinking about the self-possession of an individual, how you have, you're insular, you're insulated, you know how you feel about yourself and your view in the world, and then thinking about whatever, everything else is projected. You making those marks, is that in specific reference to the just the long history and the things that you've said about the ghosting of that lynched man, or the nylon veil?
I am not a creationist. I don't believe in that. None of it. I come out of evolution. To evolve, you know, there are two major stages in the evolutionary process. One is Darwinian, natural, and the other one is synthetic. All of us, everybody in this room and everybody on the planet, has been under the influence and are in the influence of synthetic evolution. We are evolving, whether you like it or not, or whether you know it or not. There's a lot of different forces out there that's shaping us, technology being the main one. I grew up with violence. Yes, violence played part in that evolutionary role, without a doubt. To cut something, to scrape something, to cut through something, to reveal the layers of something. Memory exists down in layers. It's in layers. I have a memory that reoccurs all the time. Bessemer, Alabama in the summertime was hot, muggy. The humidity would hit 89 degrees. You feel like you're in a steam bath. One of the most difficult things for me, and indeed, a lot of black kids in my neighborhood, was to walk down Third Avenue past a white swimming pool that we couldn't go in, and to see those kids there in the pool having fun in the water, but I couldn't go. That hurt. Still hurts. My older brother and some more kids, the older boys, we had a creek called Parsons Creek. They dammed it up and made a swimming pool for us. It was fantastic. It was so refreshing. I'll never forget it. We had the classical car tile and rope that we could swing from a tree and fall into it and enjoy ourselves. Would you believe it? Those bastards came one night, and the first kid that jumped in the next morning came out with bloody feet. They couldn't stand the fact that we were enjoying ourselves in a swimming pool. You hear me? Nobody forgets things like that. Of course, it's part of the evolutionary process. We have changed, I have changed, we continue to change. I'm a child of the 60s. In the 60s, we made a big deal about consciousness and layers of consciousness. I still believe in that. When I'm working, I'm very much aware of the notion of compression that takes place. All of that stuff is compressed down in those layers of pain. I have to cut it open to get to it. But when I cut it open, I'm a pragmatist. I have to put it back together. There's a lot to be compressed, and it takes a long time. There's a lot in painting that's pure formal stuff. But the formal is only a part of painting. I'm old-fashioned in that sense. I believe in plasticity and I believe in sensibility. I think that art comes out of the process of plasticity and sensibility. I try to keep it simple. I believe that plasticity in its most simplest form is to make something. How would I put it together? And I believe that sensibility is purely a matter of how I feel about something. Again, I try to keep it simple. I believe that art is simply, in its most simplest form, a structure of feelings. We all have feelings. At one time, though, the notion of a black man having feelings were denied. Was denied. But with feelings, when we learn to take those feelings and to construct them, to put them together, then we can enter the realm of art. If we want to push it further into politics, that's available too. Out of feelings, I can take it, make art out of it. I can also take it and make a politic body out of it. I believe that politics come out of feelings. I had a beautiful experience once. I live on the Olive Creek in Greece. I've been there for 44 years, 45 years now. We have a mountain in Crete. We call it Mount Ida. Mount Ida, Silurikis. The ancients claimed that that's where Zeus was born. We have a cave there. I wanted to see that cave. Now, I'm not talking a hill, I'm talking a mountain. So, the year was 1970. I said, hell, I want to walk to the top of the mountain. I want to see Zeus. So I hired a guide, another buddy I had met in Canada, my wife Mary and I. We hired a guide to go to Zeus. The guide was an old Cretan. When I say Cretan, I'm not talking about your regular Greek. I'm talking about a Cretan. These people are warriors. The Isle of Crete, the history is warfare. This man had fought in the resistance. He had fought the Germans. He would get to a spot on the mountain, a cave or something, and he would look at me and he would say, Zach, I got one right there. right at that spot. It was a marvelous trip. We were approaching the summit. I've never been so exhausted in my life. Reaching the top, Kufi we call it, you could see the whole island. The sun was like bright. The colors were amazing. It was like being on a mescaline high. So bright. This man looked at me. He says, look at this. Look how beautiful this is. Look at that. Look at the sea. Look at the mountains. Look at those colors out there. He was just ecstatic. His arms were up in the air waving. And right behind saying, it's so beautiful, he said to me, I will kill for this. A light went off in my head. I says, oh my God, I'm experiencing the beginning of the political coming out of aesthetics. Here we have nature in its most glorious form. And he says to me, I will kill for this. That kind of experience, you know? That kind of thing, it teaches you a lot. It really does. And being an artist becomes the basis of what I do. I know that down in that paint is what I want. That's where the aesthetics lies that can be used for something. The hardest thing for me in New York City in 1968, at the height of the civil rights movement, I'm looking at people getting killed down in my hometown. I'm looking at Newark, I'm looking at Watts. Vietnam War, horrific. The hardest thing for me at that period was staying in the studio. That was the most difficult thing to do, to go into the studio. I ran into George Siegel one day. I used to talk to Siegel. The United States and Russia was neck to neck about to pull the trigger on the bomb. Me, young kids, we were freaking out. We were getting high, getting drunk. The hell with it. Tomorrow we'll all be dead anyway. People were crying. People were shooting up. I remember one young lady just freaking out. George came in and said to us, he says, you're all crazy. Go back to your studios and work. He says, if they pull the trigger, it's going to happen anyway. Go work, he said. That's what George Siegel told me.
Thanks, Jack.
I went back to the studio and worked. I'm still in the studio.
We'd like to open up the floor now to questions from the audience for any of our panelists. So there are microphones on either side in the aisle. We ask you to go there and please ask questions. Anyone?
Hi, my name is Claire Beckman, and first of all, I just want to say thank you so much. This has been incredible to listen to. This is a question for anyone who wants to answer. My daughter was recently accepted to the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, and I've been really surprised and sort of horrified by some of the reactions that I get from people. I'm in the theater, and most of the people that I know are very happy for her, but some people are worried that she's going into the arts, you know? And I'm worried that there's so little enthusiasm for a young person taking that step and going in that direction. What would you say to me as a parent about the future of art in this country in general, and how a young girl who is smart and compassionate and cares about social justice, how do I encourage her?
I think I could just say something. You can send her to me. I recently accepted a position at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago.
Yay! Yay! Thank you.
And I think what I want to contribute to the discourse there is art and social justice and pushing students to really realize that we're more than artists. We are public intellectuals. We are the people that can move in and out of different positions and speak to things that we know are abuses in our society. You know, that's the way I see my responsibility as an artist and as a citizen in this country. And I think that the generation that's coming up now is in a precarious position because of technology and the fact that there's a lot of historical amnesia, a lot of apathy, a lot of ego and arrogance, and less people consciousness being concerned with reality. And we can see in this exhibition here how important that really is to step up and contribute to the legacies and the ways that this country has evolved in a way that the things have remained the same. And so I think you should encourage her to find her voice and to find the right medium to speak through to society. But you could certainly send her over. And I would love to plant some seeds in her.
Someone else?
Question for Bruce Davidson. You were saying how your photos are more a reflection of yourself than...
I'm having trouble hearing.
Oh, I can talk louder.
Mike, look at the
just
mic.
Just speak a little louder, please.
Okay, yeah, you were saying how your photos are a reflection of you as a person. And I was wondering if you went back to the 60s now, or if you were the age that you are now, if you would have taken all different photos, or if you think that you would have the same photos that you took.
I was 25 years old now, right?
Yeah.
What would my life be?
If you were to go back to the South at your age now, do you think the pictures you would take, if you could transpose, what I think you're saying, if you could transpose yourself now back to that moment, but with the wisdom you have at present, would your photos be different?
I don't think so. I think that I would find in the South, for instance, certain aspects of the way it was 30 or 40 years ago. There still are bigots in Mississippi. And I've experienced this a couple of times when I was with a group and someone at the other end of the room came over and said, no, that's not right. I belong to the Klan. You know, it's there. The monster is still there. You know, I mean, you can't be fooled if you check into a good hotel or motel, there'll be African Americans behind the desk. But there still is remnants of the old South in the new South. Does that answer your question? I'll tell you one thing. I work in series. I need to go into a world and explore it. Right now, I'm having a time of my life. I'm photographing almost every day in the Museum of Natural History, where none of the subjects can get me. And I can transform them. I'm God to them. They may be dead, but I'm God. And I can't wait to go back and explore death, making it come alive. So I'm still lead in the pencil. It's the way I live. And as a matter of fact, it's a little too personal, but all of my family are involved with photography in one way or another. I have a daughter who is an activist, spent 10 years in Cuba over a 10-year period, and having that work published now, after all these years, finally found the right publisher. So I have another daughter who's a painter. My wife just completed a book on the leader of the Brooklyn Gang, and it took her 8 years. So it's all part of the way we live. So you don't have a problem. You just have a camera and walk around. That's what I would suggest doing.
One more question? Anyone?
Hi, everyone. Thank you for this wonderful panel. I want to say I'm so proud to see LaToya and Abigail up there. Not only are they friends of mine, but it's interesting to see how in the panel, it has evolved in the way that now the younger generation are represented by two women of color. Question is specifically to Abigail and LaToya, if you could speak a bit about how your position as young women of African descent has shaped your experiences, not necessarily with regards to your art, but how your art is received. Like, do you find any resistance? Because I know, LaToya, you mentioned earlier that people are always asking, why are you doing this type of art? And do you find that the fact that you're young women of color, if that adds a dimension to the resistance that you experience?
You want to start? It's been hard. Like, just to speak frankly and truthfully, it's been very hard. When I set out to make the notion of family, and this book is coming out with Aperture Foundation this coming fall, when I set out to make that work, it was an image that I saw that gave me the understanding of the power of documentary and photography, and it was Gordon Parks' image of Ella Watson holding that broom in front of the American flag. I knew by looking at that, there was dignity and humanity there, and Parks saw that dignity and humanity and preserved it, but there was also that underlying narrative and fact that no matter how hard she worked or what she gave, she would always be devalued and invisible. She would never have the upward mobility, and you know that would limit her social and economic progress. Once you pick up a camera or any tool and you start to speak towards poverty, poor people, under-recognized, underrepresented people, there is automatically a blacklisting and resentment towards you for doing it. There is, you know, the art world is one of the most segregated, racist terrains. It's one of the most gender-biased terrains. I have worked really hard, you know, to get my work in collections and to be taken seriously. And there's been resistance on a class level, upper-class people, wealthier people, who don't think my work should be in these institutions. We have fought diligently to see ourselves in these museums. What's the point of going to a museum if you can't see yourself? I'm always being told about an elite white person or an international person. I think it's very necessary for me and Abigail to be present and to keep pushing our work into these arenas because we need that. I need to be able to go to a museum and see a reflection of my culture and my class. You know, I've always been really excited about Abigail's work. I mean, I've been documenting Abigail's work since we met at Skowhegan in 2007. And to tie this back into Ella Watson, the image of her in front of that flag, Abigail's been making these amazing flag paintings and tapestries. And what struck me about Abigail's work in particular, and can you tell me the title of the piece with your grandmother's lottery cards? 449. And you were making that at Skowhegan? I mean, it touched me and resonated with me on so many levels because here I am, a person working with representational images of bodies and people in reality, but Abigail was seeing the same thing through materials and through these lottery tickets and her grandmother's invisibility and her living in those projects in the Bronx all those years and her family's history there. And that's also why this panel is interesting, because you have Bruce, you have Mark, and then you have Jack, and across it, we're all grappling with these human issues and issues of human rights and social justice, but on the one hand, it's through an image, on another hand, it's through material. And there was a beautiful quote in the exhibition by John Outerbridge. What is available to you is not mere material, but the material and the essence of the political climate, the material and the debris of social issues. I saw that and I was like, Abigail, come and read this, come and see this. This is so you, you know? And also when we saw Jack Whitten's piece, Abigail has spent a lot of time thinking about invisibility, invisible man, as well as Du Bois. And, you know, it's been a tremendous and wonderful experience to grow with Abigail coming out of an art residency as art kids that were clueless about the art world and the market and how we position ourselves to grow into where we are today. And, you know, I'm thankful that I have a companion and an artist that has influenced my work and that we continue to push each other and make sure that we're here. But I mean, you can add to
respond.
I mean, she said it all, but just to jump on that material thing, there was the painting that Latoya was talking about. I collected my grandmother's lotto tickets over maybe a 2-year period, and I held on to them. I didn't know what to do with them, but 449 was the first number that she hit, and she was like lifelong hooked after that. 50-cent box, all that, but I think that there's enough information within the material that you find in life, day to day, bastardized materials. I collected her cigarette butts and made a painting. But to think about within that material has a whole history, besides social history, economic history, and the things that people have access and are made readily available to them. But then there also their relationship to that material, or the fact that she pulled on those cigarettes, and so that a part and essence of her was trapped and left within that material, so that I can make a record of my grandmother's existence with something that she breathed from or breathed through. Just thinking about the power of material as an archaeological like evidence of a life lived.
Thank you. Thanks everyone for being with us, and please stay tuned for our second roundtable, which will start in 15 minutes.